We're getting down to the final stretch, and we really do want to make sure that we leave some time this afternoon for comments and discussion among all of us. This is an opportunity for all of us to engage, and we just had so many people say yes to come and speak at this that it just got the agenda got very tight, but as you could tell, it was still an incredibly rich day, and will continue to be, especially with our next two speakers. Dr. Ronald Kessler is the McNeil Family Professor of Healthcare Policy at Harvard Medical School. His research deals broadly with the social determinants of mental health and illness as studied from an epidemiological perspective. He's the author of over 600 publications and the recipient of many awards for his research. He has been rated as the most widely cited researcher in the world in the field of psychiatry for each of the past 10 years and is a member of both the Institute of Medicine and the National Academy of Sciences. We are just so honored to have Dr. Ron Kessler here. Please welcome him.
Thanks, Caitlin. It's a great pleasure to be here. This is the third meeting I've been to in the last few months. Talking about ideas to deal with the problem of veteran suicide. The first was in October at the White House, and then last month I went to a hackathon at the Boston VA where a bunch of bright 18-year-olds from MIT talked about their various apps for things, and now here, and I understand that the same group that ran the Boston hackathon is now going to have a hackathon at the White House in the next month. It's pretty clear from those meetings that there's an enormous number of good ideas out there about how to tackle the problem of veteran suicide, but it's important to recognize that most of these ideas have to do with prevention rather than treatment. And by prevention, I mean things like stress inoculation or resilience training to prevent people from being mentally ill, or meaning-making kind of things, creating purpose with life with caring letters and so forth to give people some options, or more proximate kind of preventive interventions for people who are already suicidal, means restrictions, so taking weapons away from people who are suicidal, or training peers in how to recognize signs and symptoms so they can imminently intervene. It's important to realize that the science of prevention is much less developed than the science of treatment, and that's especially true when it comes to mental disorders. In physical medicine, it's somewhat different. Cardiologists, for example, spend just as much time, if not more, telling their patients to diet and exercise and stop smoking and so forth as they do giving them medications. Because for many years, cardiologists have been doing research, looking upstream at trying to understand the subtle causal dynamics that lead to the eventual occurrence of a heart attack. We don't do that in the mental health arena. As a matter of fact, I think we could not uncharitably refer to ourselves as practicing 1950s cardiology, which is we're waiting around for the heart attack to happen. And once that happens, we have a fire drill for handle it, but we don't really do a very good job of prevention. And because of that, it's very heartening to hear all these great ideas that have been coming out in the last several meetings. And some of them, of course, as Mr. Selke pointed out, are sort of no-brainers. They're common sense kind of things where there's no cost. It's very unlikely that they're going to have any downside effects. So you just should do them if you have any common sense. Now, there is this issue of how much common sense there is in the system, you know, which we could have another conversation about over a drink. But you know, some of those things are good to do. On the other hand, there's many prevention things where I think it's fair to say that we have to realize that they're not going to provide quick answers that we need right now to tackle the current problem of veteran suicide. And the reason is that prevention science is not developed enough. It takes a long time to work out whether preventive interventions work. And for many preventive interventions, there are dangers as well as opportunities. So you might be familiar with the Samaritans program of trying to develop peer networks to get people to be aware of somebody in their network being suicidal. It was a total disaster. You got to think some of these things through because there are some really bad effects you can have if you don't get it right. And because we don't know very much about prevention, you have to think long and hard before you put some of these things in place. If prevention is not the quick answer, then what is? And I think it is quality improvement for treatment. And the quick reason for that is that because the vast majority of people who die by suicide are mentally ill. And if those mental illnesses were treated adequately, they would not have died. Now, if you think of the Army as a microcosm, and I do some work in the Army, even though the suicide rate in the Army is quite elevated compared to the general population, 75% of soldiers have no evidence in medical records or in screening surveys of any mental illness. And that's 75% of soldiers. Their suicide rate is substantially lower than the civilian population. It's only that 1 out of 4 where there is evidence of mental illness, where the high suicide rate is. And in fact, particularly in the less than 1% of soldiers who are in a hospital in a given year for a mental health problem, and the 11% who are seen as outpatients by a mental health specialist, that 12%, there's a very high suicide rate. If we could deal with the suicide problem in that 12%, we deal with 100% of the excess suicide in the Army. We have them in their hands. They're in treatment. And the people who die from suicide who are in treatment for mental health problems are not the ones where the mental disorders were treated successfully. They're the ones that are the failures. As a matter of fact, for the most part, they're not in treatment anymore. They used to be in treatment. They were in pain. They felt hopeless. They had failed 3 or 4 times in their life. They finally got up the gumption to go and ask for somebody from help, and they failed again. The treatment failed them. And maybe they'll try another course of treatment and that fails again, and then they quit, and then they take their lives. Now, the good news is that we can do a lot better than this, because dramatic treatment quality improvements can be achieved with the current treatments we have available in a relatively short period of time, I think, by doing a better job of selecting the right treatments for the right people at the right time. Now, and I think this could also unclog the treatment backup system, because instead of having to have the revolving door kind of process we have currently with treatment, you treat them right the first time. Now, the critical insight here is the following. There are an incredible array of treatments available for mental disorders. If you go to the VHA website and look under PTSD for patients, it lists 7 different kinds of psychotherapy. And there are a couple more that are on the way. Over 24 different medications. Countless numbers of mixes and matches between psychotherapy A and medication B, as well as polypharmacy, medication A and medication B and a little bit of medication C. And that's not to mention the more heroic things, ECT, deep brain stimulation, now rescue medications, ketamine, which was just in the Washington Post this morning. Which one is right for which patient? And the answer is we don't know. But here's what we do know, that all those treatments are evidence-based. And by evidence-based, we mean in an experiment, somebody either received a sugar pill or an active pharmacologic treatment or a waiting list or a psychotherapy, and experimentally we showed that the treatment had a significant improvement on outcomes, comparatively speaking. Significant improvement does not mean that everybody was cured, though. It typically means that about 30% of people recover. 30%. So that means if you take this vast array of treatments, and all of them are pretty much the same, if you take one that's appropriate for 100 patients who have a particular illness, you pick one out of the hat, and you give it to them, 30 will recover. But here's the interesting fact. If you take the other 70, and you pick another one out of the hat, and give that one to the 70 who didn't recover, 30% of them will recover. And if you take the people who didn't recover from the first 2, you take another one out of the hat, between 20 and 25% of those will recover. The moral of the story is, if you can keep patients in treatment long enough, the vast majority of them recover. The problem is we cannot keep them in treatment for long enough because they have mental health problems. They get discouraged. They give up. After the first treatment, most of them are gone. Can we, since for the vast majority of patients there's something out there in our armamentarium that works, can we do a job of figuring out what it is quicker? The answer is yes. We can do it by using the principles of precision medicine that have been laid out in the president's initiative recently and are used in many areas of physical medicine to personalize the right treatment for the right soldier at the right time or the right veteran at the right time. We have a better chance of doing this in the mental health arena than in virtually any physical disorder because the big trick in personalized medicine is finding predictors of differential treatment response. And as it happens, we have about 50 of them in the mental health domain. Lots of small clinical trials have been carried out where they've randomized patients to treatment A or treatment B and found that women respond better than this and that, or people with certain personality characteristics and so forth. 50 different predictors. What if we took all 50 predictors, put them together, and tried to develop optimal treatment rules for patients in VA? Nobody's ever tried it. What would the effect be? Well, the closest we've come is there have been several studies that have looked at maybe 15 of these predictors in pairs of treatment and found that when you randomize people to treatment A or B, 30% recover, either A or B. But if you develop prediction equations to say, who are the kind of people that would be optimal for A, who for B, and you say, what if we had, instead of randomizing it, you gave the people where A was the best one, A, B, B, it looks like about 65% would recover, not 30%. That's with only two treatment options and 15 predictors, not the full array of treatment options and 50 predictors. Could we put this together? Absolutely. It would probably take 18 months. The VA is in a perfect position to do it because they're the only system that's organized enough where there's not enough of a profit motive that people really want to do the good thing and they should do it. It should be the first thing we do. It's sort of low-hanging fruit, sort of the no-brainer, common sense from a scientific point of view. It's a crime that we don't do that. It's not going to answer all the problems, but it's our best hope for quickly taking a big chunk out of the problem. Again, it's between here and there, more quickly than anything else I can think of. So with that, I will stop. Thank you.